In this video, we'll present the contralateral transcallosal approach to a basal ganglia cavernous malformation. As you can see in these MRI images, it extends all the way from the basal ganglia down to the carotid cistern and sylvian fissure. Here's the video showing that the head position is turned 90 degrees with the nose to the right, the back of the head to the left, and the right hemisphere is in the dependent position. This is the view down the falx to the cistern between the frontal lobes where we identify the callosomarginal arteries. As the arachnoid between the frontal lobes is separated, we get down to the pericallosal arteries and the corpus callosum. The corpus callosum has this glistening white appearance, which distinguishes it from the cingulate gyrus. Now the corpus callosum is cauterized and divided. The bipolar is used to spread the fibers of the corpus callosum all the way down to the ependyma of the lateral ventricle. The ependyma is then cauterized and entered, and we gain access to the lateral ventricle on the left side. This is the contralateral trajectory, which visualizes the lateral wall of the left ventricle. You can see the foramen of Monroe and its choroid plexus there. You can also see the venous malformation overlying the lateral wall. There is hemosiderin staining, which indicates the underlying location of the cavernous malformation. By working between the fingers of the venous malformation, the cavernous malformation can be identified and entered. You see there organized blood and gliosis around the cavernous malformation. The plane between the malformation and the adjacent brain is developed, and the pockets within the cavernous malformation are opened and evacuated. This allows the malformation to be decompressed and removed piecemeal. Here is a piece of the cavernous malformation being removed to help debulk the lesion. The malformation is seen here being separated from its gliotic plane. There's this scar tissue that helps to separate it from the adjacent brain. As the depths of the malformation are reached, we see a glimpse here of the underlying optic apparatus. We have now gone through the cavity all the way down to the carotid cistern on the contralateral side. You can see the perforators overlying the optic nerve and the surrounding arachnoid. A cottonoid is placed underneath the malformation so as to protect the underlying optic nerve. With that protective layer in place, the malformation can be continued to be dissected. The gliotic plane is developed, and the malformation is mobilized upward away from this gliotic plane. You can see a pocket of old blood that here is being entered and evacuated. By entering these pockets and evacuating their contents, the mass of the lesion is debulked. This slackens the malformation and allows it to be more mobile. The posterior border of the malformation is being dissected here. You can see the extent of this large malformation and its various portions extending both medially, posteriorly, and laterally. Here the plane of separation is being developed. You can see this nice gliotic margin that helps facilitate the separation. Another piece of malformation is removed there, and we continue our dissection laterally. You can see a glimpse of the middle cerebral artery through the depths of the resection cavity. This is to show the extent of our reach all the way into the sylvian fissure on the contralateral side. A cottonoid is being placed over the middle cerebral artery to protect the M1 segment and its lenticulostriate vessels. The malformation is then mobilized so that the final portions can be freed. The malformation has been circumferentially separated and dissected, and now is being removed as one piece. Here is a view of the carotid bifurcation, the A1 and M1 segments, with its extent all the way down to end of the cavity. This is the view into the third ventricle with the mammillary bodies present. again, showing the extent of the reach of this contralateral exposure. The floor of the third ventricle in front of the mammillary bodies has been opened in order to communicate the third ventricle with the interpeduncular cistern. This is to prevent any hydrocephalus postoperatively. This shows an overview of the resection cavity with preservation of the venous malformation, complete removal of the malformation with gliotic membranes on all sides. These postoperative images show the malformation has been completely resected. The patient recovered well from his hemiparkinsonism, and his cognitive deficits also improved.